Welcome back. Will Uganda take a preemptive strike on the elusive LRA leader Joseph Kony? What about the economic implication of the war? Tonight we are hosting the Minister of State for International Affairs, Honorable Okello Oryem. Uganda exports to South Sudan averaged $389 million in the year 2008 alone, according to World Bank data. And this money is the country likely to lose, potentially lose, if the Sudan conflict escalates. What is your strategy for Uganda to move on as a country? Because $389 million, that's equivalent to 980 billion shillings.
It is a lot of money. It is a lot of money. That is why, if you read my, followed my other statements, I have called and continue to call for tolerance, patience between the two countries. I've called for dialogue. I've asked them to come to a round table and discuss the two differences, Sudan and South Sudan, and deal with issues that were not, that brought this situation into war at the moment, and mainly issues that were not dealt with within the CPA, as a comprehensive peace agreement. So what we are urging is that please restrain yourselves from going to war. Please be tolerant. Avoid a provocation of each other and come and sit down and talk. We have even offered, in fact, our ambassador is offering to, we have asked our ambassador, Betty Akech, to even send a message to the to our colleagues across that Uganda is ready even to sit in and arbitrate between the two parties if need be, even though AU is there, even though IGAD is there, but Uganda, the country, is if they want us to do it, we're ready also to come in.
But how can you do that when you are not talking to Sudan directly? You're talking to Sudan through IGAD.
Yes.
There's no first line of communication.
That's why we have now, after my statements, after the Prime Minister's statements, we then decided to ask our ambassador, Betty Akech, who is in the country now. Honorable Betty Akech, you remember her? She was the Minister for Security.
Mm-hmm.
We invited the country now, and we have given a new brief telling her that she should go back to Khartoum, where she will be there on Thursday, and lay a message to the leadership Khartoum that still there are the same issues of restraint, tolerance, and the need to come to this dialogue on the table. But more importantly, that we, if need be, and if they trust us, if they can put the suspicions aside, we are ready to dialogue between the two countries.
So you are doubting whether they trust you?
Well, this you will appreciate that what else we are comfortable with South Sudan. In my earlier statement, I said we're working towards improving.
But at the moment, you are uncomfortable. You are doubting the relationship.
There is some, you have
no trust between. There's no trust between Kampala and Khartoum.
There is some suspicion on the Khartoum side, which is unfortunate. We don't know where it comes from, but it's unfortunate. But
it comes. But it comes from Uganda backing ESPLM and Khartoum backing
LRA. We do not regret ever backing SPLM. History will judge us that we did the right thing at the time for supporting the SPLM when others had abandoned them. Today, South Sudan has got independence. The black Africans in South Sudan walk in the country proud free. And looking forward to enjoy the kind of democracy and human rights that you enjoy. This is what the black people of South Sudan enjoy now. So we don't regret in any form or manner.
Do you at one point, maybe think about it twice? That look, the people we supported, just the other day they have been having incursions into northern Uganda and areas of West Nile districts on the border with South Sudan. They have entered about twice. 210 kilometers inside, and they've claimed the territory in Uganda. These are the same people you supported.
Well,
it has happened. Members of parliament from Uganda went on a fact-finding mission. You are the Minister of State for International Affairs.
I am the Minister of International Affairs.
Yes.
In fact, I'm also the Acting Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Yes.
But let me tell you, my brother, the picture is bigger than that. this is a very small problem. It's just a storm in a teacup. If you're talking of border disputes, what about Migingo? We have had independence with Kenya for almost 49 years, but we have a border problem with Kenya and Migingo. What about Tanzania, which were shared borders for 50 years? They are also claiming some problems. The DRC, today are claiming part of Uganda because Lake Semliki has moved east. They are claiming that the border should be on the river Semliki. Where else, if you look at the old map, river Semliki was further west.
What you are telling me is that all the neighbors surrounding you today are claiming part of your land, part of the Ugandan territory, you have a dispute with them.
We are.
So who has a problem here?
We have a. We are in the process of remarking our borders. All the countries in this region are in the process of remarking their borders, and not only Uganda. All the countries are in the process of remarking their borders to ensure that these are now marked technologically, as opposed to how it was marked at the time when the colonialists.
But you are aware that members of parliament wait on a fact-finding mission.
I am fully aware.
And were held almost hostage.
It was very unfortunate.
Yes.
It was very unfortunate.
By the people you
held. I brought this to the attention of President Salva Kiir myself personally when I traveled to Sudan. I brought this to the attention of the Minister of Foreign Affairs of South Sudan when I brought it, when I visited South Sudan. And we hope that sometime this month, depending on the situation between South Sudan and Sudan, they will be able to travel as members of parliament and get a clear explanation as what happened. They'll be able to travel to Juba and talk to the president, the leadership of Juba, so that they can get a clear explanation as to why that unfortunate situation arose.
If these are the same people who are claiming the territory on the Ugandan side, and they go ahead to claim another territory in the north, does that surprise you?
I think the two cannot be comparable, because the situation on the north side is a situation between two countries, a new emerging country, which at the time of being carved out of Sudan was supposed to sit down under what is called comprehensive peace agreement and have their borders clearly marked. That position that has not been done. That has not been achieved. It's one of the issues at dispute. Among the issues of dispute is clear demarcation of the borders between Sudan and South Sudan. The issue of nationality. Who belongs to, who is a Southern Sudanese, who is a Sudanese. The issue of the Abyei. Where does Abyei belong properly? Does it belong to Sudan? Does it belong to South Sudan? The issue of the national debt. How do they share the national debt? Since Sudan has emerged, these are some of the issues that has not been resolved, and these are the issues that is escalating, becoming war now. So that is different from what is emerging between the borders of Uganda and South Sudan. The one between Uganda and South Sudan can be dealt with in a much faster and easier, and which will be dealt with soon. But the one between Sudan and South Sudan is more complicated.
Okay, back on the economic issues. Many Ugandans have invested in Southern Sudan, and of course Uganda is getting money from South Sudan. They're exporting all sorts of things. What are you telling the Ugandan businessman who has put money in South Sudan today? Because he could be scared. What is the intervention to calm the
animals? I am telling them that depending where they are in Sudan, they should keep a low profile. They should not in any way or form participate or utter statements that can easily be misinterpreted in these two countries as to what their intentions are or what their interests are in the conflict between the two countries. And if at any time any group of Ugandans or any individual Ugandans feel threatened and have to leave South Sudan, they should inform our embassy in Juba, and we'll see how best to have them evacuated from South Sudan. We have already informed our embassy, and we have contingency plans to evacuate Ugandans if and when they have to be evacuated.
How about mitigating the economic shocks that we could feel? You could get a financial squeeze.
Yeah. We hope that this unfortunate situation should come to an early end and a logical conclusion. We will continue talking, urging the AU, urging the Security Council to put pressure on both countries. We will continue reaching out now through this new position that we have taken to reach out to Khartoum and reach out to South Sudan for arbitration. We think that it's in the interest of everybody in the region that this matter is resolved quickly and urgently to avoid not only loss of death, but also to ensure that people's livelihood is secured and people get on their lives as normal.
I just want to know what goes on inside the corridors of power. I had an opportunity to sit in the same room at the COMESA summit in Victoria Falls in Zimbabwe, where President Museveni was seated with the President General Bashir. And they were exchanging a lively, happy, wholehearted kind of laughter. And I do not understand when the two returned to their capitals and the words are different. I thought these were friends of, you know, of childhood friends, you could say. What happens in the corridors of power? How come when people are in Kampala or in Khartoum, the talk is different?
I think on the Ugandan side, I can assure you that there is genuine intentions and genuine wish for peace and genuine wish for creating an amicable, friendly relationship with Sudan, genuinely. President Museveni, not so long ago in January this year, met again with Bashir in the summit, the AU summit in Addis Ababa. They sat virtually almost next to each other. They shook hands and they talked. But I think that there is much more that we could do to improve this relationship and to remove the suspicions and the individuals who are behind some of this that creates some of this unfortunate situation. We're working on that, and I can assure you that as long as I'm in this position, hopefully, inshallah, we will soon be having a more friendly relationship with and a cordial relationship with Sudan.
It's almost 7 months now, and I'm concluding this. You're acting Minister of Foreign Affairs, and also you have your own docket. I mean, you're holding the fort. How is it?
Well, I'm managing, and I hope I'm managing well. I have a duty to my country, and I'm trying my level best to ensure that I do it to my level best.
And today, Grace, in conclusion, are you for the restoration of term limits or for the life presidency, Mr. Riam?
I think people, Ugandans, are wasting precious time in discussion of the term limits. We have just come out of elections. There is nothing special about the term limits. I lived in the United Kingdom for well over 20 years. I studied the politics of the United Kingdom, of the Europeans. There's no term limits in the UK. There's no term limits in France.
Honorable O'Kellerium.
It is not of interest to anybody. Honorable Let us O'Kellerium. Concentrate on fighting poverty. Let us concentrate on dealing with the issue of malaria, which is killing our people, HIV, AIDS, and improving our economy. Let us stop wasting time on the eventual issues of term limits. We should spend more time in things that will turn this country and transform this country to a better place for us to live in.
You seem to not be having good results there, but Honorable O'Kellerium, thank you very much for being our guest tonight.
Pleasure, I'm honored. I hope to be back here soon.
Viewers, that brings us to the end of tonight's debate. Thank you for being with us. Until next week, enjoy the rest of your viewing. On behalf of the entire production team, I'm Patrick Kamara. Good night and God bless.